Yama has come, death has come, and Savitri feels that Satyavan has been taken away from her. So now we are entering part three of the poem. There are three parts. This is the last, third and last part, and it contains book 9, 10, 11 and 12. And this is book 9, the book of eternal night, which has two cantos. This is the first one, towards the black void, the black emptiness. So was she left alone in the huge wood, surrounded by a dim, unthinking world, her husband's corpse on her forsaken breast. In her vast, silent spirit, motionless, she measured not her loss with helpless thoughts, nor rent with tears the marble seals of pain. She rose not yet to face the dreadful God. Over the body she loved, her soul leaned out in a great stillness without stir or voice, as if her mind had died with Satyavan. But still the human heart in her beat on, aware still of his being near to hers. Closely she clasped to her the mute, lifeless form, as though to guard the oneness they had been and keep the spirit still within its frame. Then, suddenly, there came on her the change which in tremendous moments of our lives can overtake sometimes the human soul and hold it up towards its luminous source. The veil is torn. The thinker is no more, only the spirit sees, and all is known. Then a calm power seated above our brows is seen, unshaken by our thoughts and deeds. Its stillness bears the voices of the world. Immobile, it moves nature, looks on life. It shapes immutably its far-seen ends. Untouched and tranquil, amid error and tears, and measureless above our striving wills, its gaze controls the turbulent whirl of things. To mate with the glory it sees, the spirit grows. The voice of life is tuned to infinite sounds, the moments on great wings of lightning come, and God-like thoughts surprise the mind of earth. Into the soul's splendor and intensity, a crescent of miraculous birth is tossed, whose horn of mystery floats in a bright void, as into a heaven of strength and silence, thought is ravished. All this living mortal clay is seized, and in a swift and fiery flood of touches shaped by a harmonist unseen, a new sight comes, new voices in us form, a body of the music of the gods. Immortal yearnings without name leap down. Large quiverings of Godhead seeking run and weave upon a puissant field of calm, a high and lonely ecstasy of will. This, in a moment's depths, was born in her. Who will start today? Rosa? Yes.
So, was the left alone, she left alone in the huge wood surrounded by a dim, unthinking world, her husband's corpse on her forsaken breast.
Yes. So there's she, Savitri. She went into the wood with Satyavan. Now she's left alone in this huge wood. She feels herself surrounded by this world of the forest, this dim, unthinking world. In the forest there is life, but there's not that human world of thought. And she was sitting under a tree with Satyavan, embracing Satyavan. So now it's his corpse, his dead body, which is lying on her breast. And Sri Aurobindo says her forsaken breast, the spirit of Satyavan, has left her. She feels abandoned, lost. Andres.
In her vast silence, spirit motionless, she measured not her loss with helpless thoughts, nor rent with tears the marble seals of pain. She rose not yet to face the dreadful God.
Yes. So she has done her work, her yoga, her tapasya. So she is not going to now waste her energy with helpless thoughts. She's not thinking like that. She's prepared herself, no? And he says, she doesn't rend with tears the marble seals of pain. The pain that she's feeling is intense, but she doesn't release that pain in the form of tears. It's as if it is frozen. It's hard like marble, like stone. And she does not yet, he says, rise. She doesn't yet stand up to face that dreadful God, that presence of the God of death that she feels there with her.
Ohne Worte schlacht, Person ihn out. Your grace stillness without stir or voice. As if her mind had died to such a moment.
So it's as if the mind has gone. It's died completely with his death. But her soul is leaning over this body in a great stillness. There's no movement, there's no voice, a deep calm and silence. So she is still alive, her mind has fallen silent, but the heart is still beating and feeling, and she is aware of Satyavan's being, still close to her, near to hers. And so she continues to embrace closely, she clasps to her, she embraces, she holds to her this mute, silent, lifeless form. And it's as if she wants to keep and protect, to guard the oneness that they had been. They had been like one being in two bodies. This oneness that was theirs. She wants to hold on to that and to keep his spirit still within the frame, within the body. So by embracing him, she can keep his spirit there in the body. Sarojini.
Then suddenly there come unmarked the change, which in common moments of our lives. Can overtake sometimes the whole human soul and hold it up towards its luminous source.
Yes. But something changes in her. Suddenly, a change comes on her. It happens to her. And Sri Aurobindo says this change that happened to Savitri in that moment, it happens to other human beings too, in tremendous moments, very, very significant, powerful, challenging moments of our lives. Sometimes that this change can come on the human soul, as if the soul is lifted up towards its luminous source. You know the meaning of this word luminous, Suresh? So there's a light above your head, no? We can't see the bulb, but the light is luminous. It's giving light. Something that's luminous. It's sending out light. So it's like that, that the source, the origin, from where our soul has come is luminous. It's full of light. It's sending light all the time to our souls, but there are these special moments, challenging moments, important moments in our lives, when we can feel as if our soul is lifted up towards that source that it has come from. And Sri Aurobindo's, in the next sentences, he's going to describe that change. Sergei.
The veil is gone. The thing is no more. Only the spirit sees and holds on.
Yes. So that veil, which is usually separating us or our soul from its source, that veil or curtain or covering gets torn. That veil is connected with our mind. So the thinker, when the thinker is no more, when it's no more in the way, then the spirit which is within all this, but which is disguised and covered by all this, only the spirit is seeing, and everything is known as a feeling of knowledge.
So here the veil is mind, not ignorance.
Here the veil is mind, yes, which is ignorant, of course. Lady in the front row. Will you read?
Then a calm power seated above arose, is seen unshaken by our thoughts and deeds. Its stillness bears the voices of the world. Immobile, it moves, nature puts on life.
Thank you. A calm power is seated somewhere above our brows. This is our brows. Above that, the soul becomes aware of that. That calm power, which is not shaken, it's not disturbed or troubled by our thoughts or our deeds, anything that we do. No? It is still, steady, silent, calm, and that stillness bears, it just supports all the voices of the world. When we become aware of that silence, we understand that all these sounds that are coming to our physical ears, they couldn't happen at all if it weren't for that stillness which is supporting them. That calm power is immobile. It doesn't move, but it is moving nature, and it is observing, watching life. These lines remind me of a sonnet of Sri Aurobindo's, a short poem. I think it's called The Godhead. He describes an experience that he had before he took up yoga. When he first returned to India, he was employed in Baroda. And there, one day he had the experience that he was riding in a tonga, a horse-drawn carriage. When I first came to India, they still were everywhere. Now I think instead there are the auto rickshaws. But a horse-drawn carriage, quite a flimsy thing. And something frightened that horse, and it bolted. In the busy street, Sri Aurobindo evokes that in the poem, that it was a busy street with many people, and there's this horse running wild. And in that moment, which is kind of dangerous, he became aware of this calm power seated above the brows that was controlling everything. And nothing happened. Everything went on as on. And he said, everything was as before, but only that deathless memory I bore. He said, it's something unforgettable, that experience of the calm power above the brows. And Huta has made a beautiful painting of this poem, one of her most beautiful paintings. So that power is not shaken by our thoughts and deeds. Its stillness bears, supports all the voices, all the noises and calls of the world. That power is immobile, but it moves all this movement of the universe that we call nature. And it looks on everything that happens in life. So the next sentence continues to describe that calm power. You would read?
Ships, immortal, fire, seas, ends, untouched, untouchable, with error and tears, and measureless above our chilling winds, its gaze controls the chilling world of peace.
Yes. So it, that power, is shaping its far-seen ends. There's a purpose in the world, in the movement of time and all the things that happen. The ends, it's what you're aiming at. That power is shaping, and nothing can change its will for those far-seen ends. It goes on shaping things in order to fulfill what it is intended. That power is untouched. It's not shaken or disturbed or troubled in any way. It is tranquil. This is a beautiful word. Tranquil means so quiet. It remains untouched and tranquil, even in the midst of all our human stupidity and all our human tears.
Even during the war?
Even during the war, yes. This is Sri Aurobindo. Well, no, but he looked like this during the war. He sat there, he experienced those bombs being dropped and all the terrible things. He said, I carry the sorrow of millions in my lonely breast. But that calm power is just steadily supporting and shaping, directing everything towards what must happen. It is measureless, above our striving wills. We are always deciding that this or that must happen, and we are making efforts to try and make that happen, and we feel frustrated and we think, why doesn't it happen? Our wills are striving, making effort, struggling. But that calm power is not striving. It's just shaping things to turn out the way that they should turn out. And its gaze, just the fact that it looks on life, controls the turbulent whirl of things. A whirl is when things are moving in circles, like a whirlpool in a river or in the sea. It can be very confused, all that. That is turbulent, troubled. So that's how things go on in the universe, turbulent whirls of nebulas and galaxies and human life. But that is all being controlled by the gaze of that power. Joelle.
to mate with the glory it sees, the spirit grows. The voice of life is tuned to infinite sounds. The moments on great wings of lightning gone, and godlike thoughts surprise the mind of earth.
Yes. So this is describing what happens to us in one of those special moments when we become aware of that calm power. No? Seeing that calm power, the spirit within us grows. It grows to match or try and match that glory which it sees. And some change comes over our nature being. The voice of our life gets tuned to infinite sounds. In the old days, we used to have to tune our radios to get in, to hear the channel that we wanted to hear. Or you turn the knob carefully, have I got it? Or a musician will tune his instrument to get just exactly the right note. But I think this is more in the sense of those old radios. The voice of life gets tuned to those infinite sounds, those sounds, those subtle sounds that are happening throughout the universe in the subtle worlds. And we feel the passage of time, but it's as if the moments are coming like great birds on great wings of lightning. We know how powerful it is when the lightning strikes, no? The moments are full of power and significance. And the mind of earth, our ordinary human mind, gets surprised by God-like thoughts, not human thoughts, but thoughts that have some greater power and significance. That is the effect when those special moments come. And he continues with the description of the effect it may have on us. At the back there, will you read?
Miraculous word in prose, whose horn of mystery flows in bright void.
Yes. So this is something that happens to the soul, as if the state of the soul, the soul's splendor and intensity when it has that special experience, it's as if that the soul, its state is like a sky, and in the sky suddenly there's a little crescent moon, a new moon. You know how beautiful the new moon is on the first day when we see it just before sunset. No? It's as if suddenly this crescent has appeared there, and the crescent, the name of the crescent moon, it's a shape, a crescent, but it also, the word means growing. When we see that little thin moon, we know that it's going to grow more and more and more. So that new moon is a symbol of a new birth, of something that is going to happen, no? So this, he says, it's a crescent of miraculous birth. The soul feels a new birth that has happened so miraculously, without anything to explain it. It's as if that new possibility has just been tossed, thrown into our soul. And that crescent, it has two horns. he says these are horns of mystery, because we don't know what that new birth is, what is going to come. So those are floating like a boat also in a bright void, a bright emptiness. It's a wonderful picture in just three lines. Into the soul's splendor and intensity, in those special moments, the soul feels its glory and intensity. It is a very strong feeling, compressed feeling. Into that comes this lovely new possibility of new birth, floating there in a bright emptiness, very, very mysteriously. Bom. Fiery. Yes. So this is something that happens to the body as part of that experience. It's as if this living mortal clay, our body is made of matter. No? It's matter that's a little bit more flexible than stone. We refer to this stuff that the body is made of poetically. It can be called clay because it gets shaped. No? This is living clay, but it is subject to death. This is our body. No? All this living mortal clay, it's as if it is suddenly taken hold of and seized and carried into a heaven of strength and silence. Sorry, there I have gone wrong. It's not the body that is ravished, it's the thought that is ravished. The thought is ravished into a heaven of strength and silence. And at the same time, this living mortal clay of the body is seized and it gets shaped. There's a power of harmony. A harmonist, somebody who creates harmony. We don't see that being of harmony, but it seizes the living mortal clay and shapes it. It gets shaped, and these touches, they come, there are many touches of this harmonist. They come in a swift and fiery blood touching the body. It is getting shaped, turned into something more harmonious. That's part of this new birth. Chandra.
A new sight comes, new voice in the form, the body of the music of the gods.
Yes, let's look at these two lines. We see things differently, a new sight comes, and it's as if there are voices in us, in our being, which are singing. These voices inside us form a body of the music of the gods, as a result of that harmonist touching and shaping the body. It's as if there's a conscious singing going on in a beautiful form that is like divine music. Alice.
Immortal yearnings without name leap down. Large quiverings of Godhead seeking run and weave. quiescent field of calm, the high and lonely ecstasy of will.
So another effect of all this experience is that yearnings yearning is when we long for, we want to experience or have something, but we feel it's difficult or impossible, or it won't come soon or easily. It's close to aspiration. We aspire for things that seem very difficult for us. So these are yearnings which human beings and human bodies don't usually feel. These are immortal yearnings that come from higher planes of consciousness. They come down suddenly into the being, no? And it says if something within us, there's something moving, quivering like leaves in a slight breeze, they just move a little bit, or small animals quivering. It says, if within us the Godhead, the divine part, the soul in us is moving, those are small movements, but it says large quiverings, and they are running, they are moving quickly through us, looking for something, seeking. And these movements all together, they weave something. We weave cloth, we put together different threads to make a cloth. Here, this is, we might weave also a tapestry, which is different colors of threads, which make a picture. So he says these large quiverings of Godhead, a sense of something moving, divine moving within, they are running through us, seeking, and that together they are weaving upon a field, a powerful field of calm, on a basis of calm. They come together, they build a high and lonely ecstasy of will. It's different from the things that we want in our ordinary human consciousness. Today, now we want this, and a few minutes later we want something else. This is something else. This is a high and lonely ecstasy of will. It's full of intense feeling, woven out of all these immortal yearnings and these seekings, divine seekings. It creates an unmoving, solitary, powerful will. Praveen.
This in a moment's death was born in her. Now to the limitless gaze, disclosed at seas, things barred from human thinking's earthly lids, the spirit who had hidden in nature's soul, out of his luminous nest within the world, like a vast fire, it climbed the skies.
So all this experience which Sri Aurobindo has been describing, it was born in Savitri in the depths of a moment, very suddenly, quickly, all these powerful experiences happened. And this releases the spirit. The spirit who is being hiding in nature. And he images that spirit dwelling within us in our nature being to a bird in its nest, crouched down in its nest. Now it suddenly flies up, soared, flies up powerfully, no? Out of his luminous nest within the worlds. It's as if deep in our, within the worlds, there's layer after layer after layer of worlds, material world and all the subtle worlds. In the very, very center, in that nest of light, the spirit is hidden. And now suddenly he flies up out of that. And it can be seen to the limitless gaze. It's disclosed. The spirit reveals itself to that limitless gaze of that calm power that sees things that are barred from the earthly lids of our human thinkings. Lids means the eyelids. So there are things which our physical eyes cannot see. There are things which are barred, hidden from our physical eyes, and therefore from our physical thought, our human thinking. But beyond that human thinking and physical sight, there's another kind of gaze, and that's the gaze of that calm power seated above our brows. So Savitri can see this spirit soaring up out of its luminous nest within the worlds. And it climbs up like a vast fire in the darkness, bonfire flaming up. Venkat.
Thus, where the thoughts of self pavilion formed, like one who looks up to far heights, she saw, ancient and strong as on a wingless summit, above her where she had worked in her own mind, gathering apart in the soul tower of self, the source of all which she had seen or wrought, the power projected into cosmic space, a slow embodiment of the Quranic will, the staring fragment of the eternal truth, the passionate instrument of an unmoved power.
So this is what happens to Savitri. The chords of self-oblivion. In our normal human state, we have forgotten who we really are. We have forgotten ourself. But in some tremendous experience, in that moment of change, the chords, the strings that are keeping us forgetful, they get torn, and suddenly we remember. No? So for Savitri, it's as if she's looking up to far heights, and there's a summit, the top of a mountain, but there's no wind there. It's not. It's in some very, very calm space, and on the top there's something that has been there for a very long time, ancient and strong on that summit, on that high place. Far above her, far above where she has been working in her isolated human mind, as we all do. No? She's been laboring, working here apart in her lonely tower, just herself, her individuality. But what she sees is the source, the place from which everything that she has seemed to be, everything that she has done has, that is the source, and everything that she has seen to be and done is a result of that ancient, strong being and presence on that windless summit. And she sees that she is, as we all are, a power of that ancient strong source which has been projected, it's been beamed out or sent out into cosmic space. It becomes a slow embodiment of the aeonic will. It's interesting, this is just what we were reading about in the Life Divine last night. Often these things happen, you know, that we were reading that behind all the movement of evolution, there's the spirit which is projecting all these forms and beings. And the forms are gradually embodying that aeonic will, that will which will be fulfilled over a very, very long stretch of time, an eon. It's a very long time, like the yugas. These are eons, long stretches of time. So this, what is projected from the source, is a slow embodiment of the aeonic will. It's also a starry fragment, a tiny little shining light like a star, but that light is the light of the eternal truth. And that embodied being, that individualized projection of the power, that slow embodiment, is also the passionate instrument of an unmoved power. Passionate in the sense of having strong feelings and suffering. We are passionate instruments and we get excited about things and we think it has to be like this or that. But each of us is an instrument of that unmoved power which is our source. I think I would like to stop there today. We can take time and read these lines again. Try and take them, take the rhythm into us and understand deeply the wonderful things that Sri Aurobindo is sharing with us in these lines.
So was she left alone in the huge wood, surrounded by a dim, unthinking world, her husband's corpse on her forsaken breast. In her vast, silent spirit, motionless, she measured not her loss with helpless thoughts, nor rent with tears the marble seals of pain. She rose not yet to face the dreadful God. Over the body she loved, her soul leaned out in a great stillness, without stir or voice, as if her mind had died with Satyavan. But still the human heart in her beat on, aware still of his being near to hers. Closely she clasped to her the mute, lifeless form, as though to guard the oneness they had been, and keep the spirit still within its frame. Then suddenly there came on her the change which in tremendous moments of our lives can overtake sometimes the human soul and hold it up towards its luminous source. The veil is torn, the thinker is no more, only the spirit sees, and all is known. Then a calm power seated above our brows is seen, unshaken by our thoughts and deeds. Its stillness bears the voices of the world. Immobile, it moves nature, looks on life. It shapes immutably its far-seen ends. Untouched and tranquil amid error and tears, and measureless above our striving wills, its gaze controls the turbulent whirl of things. To mate with the glory it sees, the spirit grows. The voice of life is tuned to infinite sounds. The moments on great wings of lightning come, and godlike thoughts surprise the mind of earth. Into the soul's splendor and intensity, a crescent of miraculous birth is tossed, whose horn of mystery floats in a bright void. As into a heaven of strength and silence, thought is ravished. All this living mortal clay is seized, and in a swift and fiery flood of touches shaped by a harmonist unseen. A new sight comes, new voices in us form a body of the music of the gods. Immortal yearnings without name leap down. Large quiverings of Godhead seeking run and weave upon a puissant field of calm, a high and lonely ecstasy of will. This, in a moment's depths, was born in her. Now, to the limitless gaze disclosed that sees things barred from human thinking's earthly lids, the spirit who had hidden in nature soared out of his luminous nest within the worlds. Like a vast fire, it climbed the skies of night. Thus were the cords of self-oblivion torn. Like one who looks up to far heights, she saw, ancient and strong as on a windless summit, above her where she had worked in her lone mind, laboring apart in a soul tower of self. The source of all which she had seemed or wrought. A power projected into cosmic space. A slow embodiment of the aeonic will. A starry fragment of the eternal truth, the passionate instrument of an unmoved power.